Well now, your day just got better. It's Public Image the Musical, featuring an all-star cast of marketing experts. It's time to access your amazing photographic memory, or you can just get something to write with. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Rotary International Director of Zones 28 and 32, Valerie Wafer.
Wow, it's so great to be with all of you for this really fun event. And if you've joined us previously for our Zone 2832 Director Dialogue Series, you know that each session has been unique. Protecting our environment, elevating Rotaract, and last month's session was on positive peace. Well, tonight we have something very unique, Public Image, the Musical. And this is special for many reasons. First, how we market Rotary to each other and to the outside world is critical to our success. And second, this event is a joint effort of our Zones 28 and 32 public image teams, a unique combination of talent and skill sets that will not only help you tonight, but more importantly, each cast member is available to speak to your Rotarians virtually and hopefully soon in person. I want to thank our public image coordinators, Michelle O'Brien, Nikki Medeiros, and Michelangelo Caruso for all they're doing to improve the quality and effectiveness of our marketing. Finally, this event is special because tonight, you and hundreds of other Rotary public image champions are going to get even better at growing clubs, raising money, and getting the word out about our great organization. Okay, let's get started with Public Image the Musical. Ladies and gentlemen, your MC this evening is Michelangelo Caruso.
Hi, everybody. Thank you so much for attending. Thank you, Director Valerie. I love the energy here. Thank you so much. The cast and crew have a fantastic program for you tonight. Just some quick announcements before we get started, everybody. We want to thank the event registrars, Bruce and Sue Goldson, for doing such a good job. They work behind the scenes to register, I think, about 650 people for this event. And of course, not everybody is going to be able to attend, but everybody who did register is going to receive the souvenir playbill. We think this might be the largest public image event of its kind ever in our area, and we're so glad that you can take part in it. Remember to visit the Zone 2832 website, and may I be a little bit more specific, please join that Facebook group. Some of you may not have joined yet. We need you to be part of that because we are communicating a lot of salient points for you in Zone 2832 website and also the Zone 2832 Facebook page. That's what we really want you to join. Visit the website, join the page. This program souvenir that I speak of, the musical playbill, has tons of resources to help you improve your Rotary marketing campaigns moving forward, including contact information for our cast members / consultants this evening. You can also access these experts, your new BFFs, on the Zone 2832 Facebook pages, that page, where link up with them there. Okay. Cast, are you ready? Audience, are you ready? And now it's time for Act One, Scene One, featuring our most tenured Zone 28 RPIC. She's going to help you with writing copy. You'll love her energy. Give it up, everybody, for Mary Lou Harrison. Walking on sunshine. Whoa. Walking on sunshine. Whoa. I'm
walking on sunshine. Well, thank you, Michael. And hello to everyone who's here for Public Image, the musical. Can you feel the sunshine? And don't it feel good? Tip one for winning words. Bring the sunshine. The world has enough bad news, and Rotary has so many amazing stories to tell. You know them. You've lived them. Tell them. Write them. Hope sells. Especially in these really challenging COVID times, people want to feel the sunshine. And more importantly, they want to bring the sunshine too. Tell them how. Write them an invitation. So how do you start? Tip two, ask the three W's before you set pen to paper, fingers to keyboard, or thumbs to a device. W number one, why are you writing? Are you inviting people to an event, sharing good news, both to attract new members and to retain your current members, or trying to raise money for our Rotary Foundation? Knowing the why is essential for persuasive writing. W number two, who's reading? Knowing your intended audience is critical. Are they already part of the Rotary family? How much background info do they need? What demographics do they represent and what issues matter to them? Your readers need to see a role for themselves in your story. W number three, what action can they take? Be very clear about what you want people to do. Come to an event, make a donation, share a good news story on social media. Use as few words as possible and make the action simple to complete. Remember that everyone's time is precious and we need to be respectful of people's time and of their ability to absorb information. Don't we all get overwhelmed by sometimes by just the sheer volume of what comes at us every day? I know I do. And that brings us to tip number three. Set the context and match your message and writing style to the situation. Ideally, you're going to write differently in an email to club members than in a tweet, an Instagram post, or something you're printing in hard copy. Consider how people are going to read what you write. So are they reading on a screen of some kind, on a poster, a brochure? People have different levels of patience depending on the presentation format and on the platform. In all your writing, be as concise as possible and be a bringer of sunshine. The world needs Rotary's light, Rotary sunshine. Back to you, Michael.
Fabulous. Let's talk quickly about copy. We're seeing some questions showing up in chat. And Mary Lou, why do you think we have a bigger problem with people being too verbose when, say, promoting events or not wordy enough?
Maybe too wordy. Every time too wordy. Every single time too wordy. We have limited bandwidth.
Yes.
So leave the audience wanting more. Make them want to click. You know, when you see the see more in a post, you want people to click on the see more.
Yes.
Less is more every time.
Thank you. And when we try to communicate about events, there are certain parts of speech that work better. For instance, adjectives. I've been told adjectives are like emotional words that can pull people in, but we often go clinical on that. We just say, we're having an event on Wednesday at 7 o'clock and we're having chicken.
You want to describe your event or someone you're introducing. For example, you could say, I'm so delighted to tell you that our keynote speaker at our Rotary training event is going to be the masterful, multi-talented and magnanimous Michelangelo Caruso. Make it fun. Use alliteration.
Thank you very much. Well done. My pleasure. Virtual round of applause for Mary Lou Harrison, everybody. And next, we want to introduce to you a former marketing executive who will help you get more from Facebook. He's young, he's handsome, and he's a fantastic dancer. Ladies and gentlemen, pay your respects to Dan Dubray.
Yeah, I'm not sure about young. Thank you, Michael. Respect, it's all about respect. R-E-S-P-E-C-T. Tell you what it means to me. We're going to talk about respect tonight in the world of Facebook. We're going to talk about respecting your audience, respecting yourself, and also respecting Facebook's business model. So first up, let's talk about respecting the audience. The simple fact is, every time you zoom into Facebook, there are 1,500 posts waiting for your attention. So your friends, your followers, your groups, fan pages you belong to, and brands are all beating down your door or your followers' door to get their attention. So their attention is valuable. It's in very scarce supply. Facebook content is not in scarce supply. Therefore, if you want to break through, no surprise, your content had got to be very, very good. It goes without saying, you know, content today on Facebook should almost always be video or an animation, something that's moving with subtitles. A lot of Facebook is done in the privacy of people's homes. They don't necessarily want everybody to hear what's going on their tablet or their phone. And of course, it's got to have great copy. As Mary Lou mentioned, you know, you've got to be the sunshine. And when you post, always, always post with a purpose. Know those three W's. If you don't, you're going to risk conditioning your followers to ignore you. And that's the last thing you want. You've built your followers over time. If they start to tune you out, it's going to be hard to get them back. And worse than that, you're actually training the Facebook algorithm to limit the reach of your posts. If people don't react to your posts because they're weak, they're not relevant, Facebook algorithm takes note and it starts to wean back who they share their posts to. So if you want to be effective on Facebook, always go for quality. Don't go for quantity. In fact, quantity of weak posts will ultimately work against you. That's because the algorithm's working 24/7. It's watching what you do. It's kind of like Santa Claus. You want to make sure what you're doing is good. Okay, so tip number one, respect your audience. Tip number two, respect yourself. Okay, so now you've put some time and energy into creating great posts. Well, how do you know what's working? Well, I come from the marketing business, and 20 or 30 years ago, I'm dating myself, there was a saying in the advertising world, you know, I know half my advertising dollars are wasted, but I don't know which half. That was 20 years ago. Guess what? We're in a digital age. We know exactly which half is wasted. Everything that is online gets measured. So respect your own efforts and create great content. Go back to the posts that you've put out there. Take a look at the insights that Facebook gives you in terms of reach and engagement and in terms of link clicks to figure out which posts are working for you and which posts didn't work for you. Stop doing what doesn't work. Focus on things that work. Engaging content will ultimately mean more followers. More followers will mean more reach for your message and more success for your clubs. So measure like you mean it. Respect yourself. That's tip number two. Tip number three, respect the Facebook business model. Guess what? Facebook is an advertising company. Full stop. That's all they are. They're not a benevolent organization here to help you, you know, connect with old friends and lurk old girlfriends. That's not what we're here. They're there for. On average, they only share 5% of the posts that you create with your followers. 5%. They actually want you to pay to easily share your posts with the other 95%. It's a pay-to-play game. Things have changed a lot in the past 10 years. Today, it is pay-to-play. So if you have something important to say, boost your posts. It's going to cost you a few cents to reach a person, so you're going to have to set a budget. That's just the way it is if we want to get a word out. Trust me, the investment in Facebook is well worth it. The reach per person is still very cost-effective compared to other mediums, especially unmeasured mediums like print. And after you've done that, go back to tip number two and benchmark what you're doing. Understand what it's going to cost per reach, understand what it's going to cost per click, and make sure that you continue to put money behind posts that are cost effective. It involves some number tumbling, but that's okay. You know, there's probably a person or two in your club who likes numbers and they actually enjoy it. So tip number three, respect the Facebook business model. That's it. Those are my three tips. So R-E-S-P-E-C-T.
Bravo, Michael. Man. A couple of follow-up questions, Dan. What is a respectable amount of engagement on a single Facebook post? We're talking now about a combination, I guess, of emoticons, likes, shares, and comments. What's a decent?
Oh, that's a good question. It really kind of depends on what your benchmark is. If you take a look at the average post today, if you have an average post, it's going to reach 5% of the people. On that post, you're probably going to generate no engagement whatsoever. What you're probably going to notice, once your reach is somewhere about 10 or 15% of the followers you've got for your page, you're going to start to see reach engagement start to percolate up there. It wouldn't be surprising to see, again, as a percentage, maybe 2 or 3% of people sharing your posts, maybe 4 or 5% of the people engaging it with some kind of a like or a love. And comments and recomments, that's the gold, really. When Facebook picks that up, on your posts that it's seeing real engagement. It's seeing conversations going across their platform. And that's when it really starts to reward you and it starts to expand your reach.
Great. Thank you very much. I know that when I do personal posts, I'm looking for about 10 pieces of engagement. That's just me. So I want to see that it's vibrating with people. And then I can even double down if I'm getting some action. Somebody had mentioned in chat that they didn't know what pay to play meant. And what Dan's referring to, everybody, is a boost. You can spend how much money, Dan? $5 to $10?
$5 to $10, yeah. Think of it in terms of how many people do you want to reach? It might cost you a penny and a half to reach somebody for sure. And so you can define the people you want to reach as just simply the followers of your page. Or if you live in a small city or a suburb, you can try to reach as many people in general population in your suburb at a penny or two per reach. Or you can try to define it as you want to reach people who are young, who are interested in public service or in volunteerism. And you can create these targets. And when you create targets, it costs a little bit more, but obviously you're planting your message with a very specific group that will hopefully, the message will resonate because you picked that group carefully.
Yeah, thank you so much. And Melissa Ward from Zone 32, also a social media expert, is correct. You want to try to define that audience, as Dan said, so that you're not just spraying everybody. Try to get to exactly the people you want to get to. That's where the effectiveness is. Dan, thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Let's move on to this next segment. I am super excited because Zone 32 assistant RPIC, Jennifer Aitken, is going to talk to us about Instagram stories. It's a great place to connect with Yo Pros or the young professionals, the 30-somethings and the 40-somethings that are so important to Rotary. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Jennifer Aitken.
We weren't born to fight. Come on and get up off your knees. Life is a bit
of fear. Hi, everyone. We weren't born to follow because we are Rotarians, but we do want to be sure that folks are following us and our clubs on Instagram. And social media stories are a great way to help increase visibility of our Rotary brand and to build and increase our following on social media. So what are stories? Stories include videos and images that appear outside of your regular Instagram feed that are only about 15 seconds long and that only last for 24 hours before they disappear. It's the temporary nature of stories that help to attract your followers to engage with the post immediately. Stories also appear at the top of the Instagram app, which is often why they often get more attention than your regular posts. Simply using the story feature is one of at least 30 proven ways to gain more followers on Instagram. But you can also increase your following by using the Discover People feature. This feature makes suggestions for accounts you should follow based upon the types of accounts you already follow and engage with. Commenting and liking posts on other people's stories will also help to increase your following. Using emojis to comment also seems to help get others to follow you back. Using the highlight feature is another proven way to get more followers. So if you put a lot of work into your story and you don't want it to disappear after 24 hours, the highlight feature enables your stories to live permanently on your profile. And those stories can later be shared as a regular post to your feed, so you can keep using that content. Instagram Stories has a lot of other interactive features which enable you to engage with your audience in a variety of different ways. You can use polling to poll your audience regarding meeting times, ideas for service projects, or to assess needs in the community. You can also invite your audience to ask you a question about Rotary, about your club, and you can answer that question using the story feature. Fundraising. The story feature can be used to promote a fundraiser and to collect funds online. So what makes a good story? Well, the Rotaract Club of Medea in District 9010 used the story tool on Instagram recently to share videos of the installation ceremony of several of their new members. It included video, music, animation, and still photos of each members with their names. A graphic of the Rotary logo was shared and contact information for the club was included. It was a great way to celebrate new members and also to get attention and draw attention to the club itself. Before I go, three tips. Adding stickers, texts, emojis, music, and animation can help to make your stories attractive and interesting. And these are all built-in features to Instagram stories. Linking your Facebook and Instagram account enables you to share stories from one account to the other seamlessly. Facebook also has a story feature too. And tip three, best time to post on Instagram for nonprofits, Tuesday 1 to 3, or Wednesday at 2 p.m. Wednesday seems to be the best day. Sunday's not the greatest day. With stories, timings can vary, but this is a good guideline to follow. So now go out there and tell your story on Instagram.
Jennifer, well done. Thank you so much. A quick question. I know that a lot of people, perhaps even on this in this session, have individual Instagram accounts. Would you recommend that clubs have an Instagram account or a district have an Instagram account?
So when I was PR chair for my club, I was in charge of social media, and I am very proud of building the following on my club Instagram account to now over 2,400 followers. So I definitely recommend Instagram for your club. When I was district public image chair, I was charged with creating an Instagram and Twitter account for the district because we already had Facebook. I definitely recommend it. Our district account is now up to over 700 followers. And again, you can link your Facebook and Instagram accounts so that when you post to one, all you have to do is click the share button and it automatically posts to the other platform. And like I said, stories can be shared from Instagram to Facebook, again, with just a click of a button.
Fabulous. Thank you very much, Jennifer. A great session. And we have a lot to learn about Instagram. I appreciate you. Well done.
Thank you.
We're getting lots of comments and questions in the chat. Remember that we're going to save this TXT and answer the questions more fully. And we'll be answering them at the Zone 2832 Facebook group. And I've posted the link to that Facebook group in chat. Just scroll up to find it, click on it. It'll open up in your browser and it'll be waiting for you after the musical concludes. I'm super excited about this next segment because Kelly Hunt, an assistant RPIC in Zone 28, is going to help you understand the magic of the database. Ladies and gentlemen, she just moved in her family into their first new house. This is Kelly Hunt. Give it up, Kelly.
You can do magic. You can have anything that you desire. Magic.
Hello, everyone. You might not believe it, but you can do magic with Club Runner. And I'm here to help you with three magical tips. The first tip is how to get your click rate. No matter if it's email, your website, your bulletin, or a social media post, you want people to click, open, and read your things. A click rate is how many people open X versus how many you send. A click-through rate is how much is clicked within X. So if you send emails to 100 members and only 20 of them open it, you have a 20% click rate on that email. And if only 5 members click a link or a button in your email, then your click-through rate is 5%. A great goal to aim for is 60% click rate on anything that you send. With Club Runner, you can view open rates, click-through rates, deliver rates, errors, and so much more. If you notice delivery and error percentage, that means your email was not delivered for some reason, usually a wrong email or a misspelling. So make sure to double check for these, as these percentages can take away from your click rate. So if you sent 100 emails to 100 people and 4 of those emails are wrong, you really only sent 96 emails and thus the percentages will be thrown off. So once you fix this issue, how do we get your recipients to actually open it? That's where we use magic tip number 2, use subject lines that work. This is by no means an extensive list, but it's a good start when learning to create subject lines in both your emails and internal articles that links that will get people clicking around and open your stuff. Such as tonight, what got you to click PI the musical? It was definitely the short and sweet, simple, no-nonsense subject line, which is tip number one. Instead of saying, here are 10 people with 10 great tips, we said PI the musical and we got you here tonight. So simple, no-nonsense subject lines. Also, use single words. Think of how effective the marketing for Apple is. It's a single letter, but they've done great with their marketing for iMac, iPhone, iPad. So simple and sweet. You can use numbers and you can use lists. People are drawn to facts and figures. So example is 10 things every Rotarian should know about your club. Questions and punctuation are also great as they draw your reader's attention. Using capital letters and lowercase to emphasize certain words and key phrases is also very great. And also, get personal. People respond better when they are addressed by name as it holds them accountable. And once you've mastered this, use final tip number three. Find the hidden secrets of ClubRunner. I urge you to get out and explore ClubRunner outside of the profile and email portion so you can better know your club and your members so you can know what to write and exactly who you are writing to. So, as Michael said, in the database, here are a few of my favorite features to get you started on knowing more about your club and your members. You can find useful information in the member directory and report section. You can use Website Designer to add buttons and links to your website to get that click rate and click-through rate up. You can build registration forms and committees for events in My Event Runner, the Event Planner Committee section, the Volunteer sections, and much more. So if you want to have an event such as tonight, you can use ClubRunner to get that started. I hope I've intrigued you to use ClubRunner and hope that you can use magic with that.
Well done, Kelly. Now, I know I want everybody to know we're not necessarily endorsing ClubRunner over DACDB. In fact, both have a lot of similar functions. I think the more important message here, Kelly, is that most people only use a very small percentage of what is available to them in their database, whatever it is. Somebody told me one time that the average person only uses 17% of their computer's capacity. Would you hazard a guess at what percentage of ClubRunner the average club uses?
I personally believe that 20 to 30% of ClubRunner is actually used, which is not that big because it's just email and the newsletter portion is the most known. And people are kind of fearful to explore around. But once you get in there, you realize it's very user-friendly and you can learn so much about your district and your club and all different kinds of committees you can get on, such as this one.
Bravo. Thank you, Kelly. Indeed, ClubRunners can be magic, and so are you. Thanks for being with us tonight.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Shifting gears a bit, large events are very important to Rotary. We mentioned earlier that all roads lead to fundraising and membership, and large events are a great way to get those two things cooking in your sales funnel. It takes almost as much effort to host a 50-person event as it does to host 100, or 150, or 500. It's time to get your ROI from big events with the man of the world himself, ladies and gentlemen, from District 6400 in Detroit, Michigan, Divankar Mukhi.
Hello, everybody. Welcome from District 6400, Wayne State University, Rotaract Club. My name is Divankar Mukhi, and as you just heard how everyone wants to rule the world, let me show you how to rule some Facebook events. So the first thing I want to share with you is utilizing Facebook events function. Facebook has a great platform in sharing events and allowing your members to RSVP and register via their own platform. They prioritize their own use of this function in their Facebook feed over putting in a Zoom link and posting that out. you can definitely use a Zoom link, but make sure you embed it into the Facebook event itself. This allows for public access to attendees. So your attendee can see if their Uncle Jim is going to the event, and that's going to push them to want to also RSVP. It also allows them to have reminders sent via Facebook. That way you don't have to worry about sending the reminders. Facebook will do it for you, and that's a great function. And finally, attendance metrics are very, very key here. This will give you and your event organizers access to what kind of people are coming, who is going, is a certain age group going, is a certain type of nationality going, is a certain type of gender going, all these different metrics you guys can use for your event. And that is very key. So that's something that is very, very useful in terms of utilizing Facebook event function. Number two, how do you promote an event? Promoting an event isn't just before the event. Promoting an event is also during and after. A lot of people may not know this, but if you actually utilize Facebook's live function during your in-person or your Zoom event, all the people who are last minute or have not maybe seen the event reminders, they can just join in. And now you're pulling in more and more people. And that's very great during the event. Afterwards, it's very important to do an event post recap. And so that is allowing yourself to post out the recording of the event and sharing out what kinds of attendees and thanking your partners that were able to make it to that event. Making sure you utilize Facebook's tag function by utilizing the at symbol and tagging relevant organizations or people that were in person or virtually attending that event. This allows for those organizations or those people to see that you tag them and allows them to now share that same post, increasing the engagement of the event for following events coming from your same team. And tip number three is in understanding how to form a posse. Forming a posse is realizing that you can invite people to events utilizing Facebook Messenger feature and writing out a nice message. It's also important to realize that you can use co-host function on each event by bringing in your team members and allowing them to be co-hosts. Facebook only allows a 500 person max cap of your invites being sent out per host of an event. If you have multiple co-hosts, now you're doing that X2, X3, X4 times of engagement and coverage. So that is something that you have to also realize is very good. Important to also realize that you don't have to be the only one promoting the event. You can utilize your district public image team or other public image gurus that are within your club or within your zone, such as our team right here, as people to send out events for you, because then we have our own reach and it's not all on you. So those are my three tips. First thing is utilize Facebook event function. Number two, promoting is not just before the event, it's during and after. And finally, the last tip is form a posse, make your co-hosts active, and boost that engagement. Thank you, everybody.
Nice job, Devonta. Hey, tell us more about why we need a Facebook event page if we already have, say, a Zoom registration page. What's the advantage to setting up that separate Facebook event page?
So Facebook likes everything in-house. They like utilizing all of their own services. So whether you're using Facebook event or Zoom, it's very important to embed that Zoom link into the Facebook event so it shows up to other people's timelines. You can also utilize location function, tag the venue of your event, and then it will show up on that venue's Facebook page as well. And anyone following that Facebook page of that venue will also see your event. So it kind of all meshes and connects in one thing. So it's very important to use Facebook events for that reason.
Excellent. Really enjoyed your segment, Devankar. And Devankar, again, all of the speakers tonight are available to consult with your club, your district, or your event committee. And the contact information is in the souvenir playbill. You can also reach out to everybody on the Zone 28 and 32 Facebook group or in the Get the Word Out Facebook group, which has high-end marketing tips for you. Thank you, Devankar. Well, next up, video marketing secrets from the guy who does our public image team videos. when we launched the Zone 28 East public image team a few months back, Brad Hollett put the video together for us. We got a lot of attention right out of the gate, and he's just fabulous to work with. He's our busy show caller this evening. Give it up, ladies and gentlemen, for Brad Hollett.
Hello, everybody. I'm Brad from behind the scenes tonight, and I'm going to speak to you a bit about video. Video works like crazy if you get your point across quickly. You have about 5 seconds to get someone's attention and 10 seconds to hook them in. A video is a commercial, and everyone knows how a commercial works. If you don't tickle them quickly, they're gone to the bathroom, they're gone to get something to eat, or even worse again, they're gone to another video, and you lose them. I use the KISS method, keep it short and sweet. Colors should be bright so everything can be seen. Videos are meant to catch the interest of people, not necessarily to sell them at that moment. It is meant to get people engaged, wanting to investigate further. It's not necessary to get them all the information in the person's hands, make them want more. Good videos are made very easily. I'm a Mac guy, so I like using Final Cut. It's a very user-friendly program that works with the audio programs that I use. But saying that, there are several great video programs out there that you can use. Adobe Premiere is the industry standard. It works close to the same as Final Cut. Each have their positive and negatives, but overall both are great. If you're on a budget, there are several free programs out there that you can use. Mac has a free one called iMovie. This is a great free program that has a lot of editing features that Final Cut has. DaVinci Resolve is another one if you have a PC and you want to start to learn the art of editing. There are tons of free Learn to video tutorials, both on YouTube and Vimeo, that can get you started. A few basic starter tips are get enough footage. Make sure you have shot everything that you need for your video. I like to use a video tree or a timeline to come up with an idea of how everything should flow before you start. Watch all your footage. Save it in multiple places because you never want to lose it. If your computer crashes, then you have it somewhere else. Get an idea of what you're trying to accomplish with your video. Edit in a quiet area. Distractions will cause you to get frustrated. Editing can take time, so don't rush. Don't get frustrated. You'll get there and you'll be very happy, somewhat. Most artists are never happy with their final product. So if that's the case, find someone else that you trust to take a look at and offer some feedback. A second set of eyes on your video will give you a different perspective and help you with your final decisions in creating event or creating a video to get the word out for you, your club, or your event. In conclusion, video will help you in the promotion of your events, sell tickets, and just a general promotion of your club. I'm always available for a talk to your club or to help you get started. Thank you very much.
Well done, Brad. Videos, like, I think it's super powerful in terms of marketing, but it is also the most difficult and the most challenging. It's got the steepest learning curve. So I know that you'll be in great demand here as people try to learn more about video. A couple of follow-up questions, man. You're a tech person. Why are tech people so weird?
Great question. No, it's only keyboard players that are weird. The rest, most techs are pretty.
It's not weird. Only keyboard players, Brad.
Oh, great. Now we're going to hear from everybody. Brad, thanks very much, man. You have been a pleasure to work with. I really admire you. Thank you for all you do for Rotary and Public Image.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
All right. You're about to hear from an old theater pro. And when I say theater, I mean theater. Your club can get more people to belong to the club if it has more money and resources to get the word out and hold great events and hold great fundraisers. So Robert Friend is an expert at fundraising, and he has raised big money for Rotary on minimal budgets. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Robert Friend. Here he comes.
Groundhog! Groundhog!
Stand. Thank you, Michael. Well, listen, storytelling is a major through line of tonight's conversation. And as we consider our fundraising activities, it's important to underscore the impact digital storytelling has on raising funds for our clubs and our districts. Expansive use of pictures and videos are worth their weight in gold, as was told. They are probably the most powerful storytelling tools when used with any digital fundraising solution and highly consequential in driving donors to your call to action. So this leads me to tip number one. In my world, data is king. In-person events will come back, right? But I'm here to tell you that virtual events are not going to go away. This is important because during the pandemic, we broke down the silos of four-wall events, and we are now reaching our communities on a local, regional, national, and international level. So why would we close these connections? This leads us to the importance of data collection. Digital events and fundraising solutions automatically guarantee our ability to gather and collect data. And when you have data, then you can communicate and invite those you touch to more Rotary-rich activities, increasing engagement with your club in high frequency. The takeaway, keep a database of your digital and on-the-ground Rotary touch connections to drive the Rotary journey. And this leads us to tip number two. The Rotary journey is a series of personal interactions and Rotary touchpoint experiences and a fantastic strategy in creating enhanced Rotary public image impact. Why? Well, consider this. If we track each Rotary relationship that we touch and continue to involve them with the work that we do, then we will deepen and grow our community engagement. The impact is exponential. So the Rotary journey begins with knowing our community and those that we touch along the Rotary continuum. For instance, the parents of our Interact Club members, or the unsung heroes and civic leaders we celebrate, or our club speakers who impart their knowledge. These are just a few of the touches that when entered into our database and actively invited to our club projects, we can build sticky and meaningful engagement connections. The result, increased membership and increased philanthropy. It's a numbers game. The Rotary journey increases our ability to aggregate engagement. And last tip number three, be bold and break outside the four walls of your club and start working in multi-club and multi-district teams. The power of creating a Rotary story based on a community, regional, national, or global need or initiative is powerful. Recently, the Million Mask Challenge Tour delivered 5 million PPE face masks to first responders, essential workers, businesses, nonprofits, families, and communities in need from District 7230 in New York City to District 7780 in Maine. So 13 districts and 416 Rotary clubs were in action together. Service drove the story, and this project allowed each club an opportunity for members to break out of their living rooms during the heart of this pandemic and focus on community, reinforcing the power and impact of our Rotary network. And each district delivered a massive PPE distribution and public image media event, delivering millions of digital Rotary impressions across the Northeast. One person, Ted Rossi, an East Hampton, Connecticut Rotarian, started this idea. He had the resources and access to a Rotary infrastructure to make it happen. Well, you can too. So my final message, think outside the box, be big and bold. As they say, light yourself on fire and people will come from miles to watch you burn. Thanks, Michael.
Well, you had me right to that last analogy, man. Robert, you are amazing. And not for nothing, that 5 million masks, that project was your project, correct?
Well, actually, it was Ted's, along with Jack Solomon, a past district governor, and District 7980. I had the honor of just project managing it, but it was an amazing event. I know there are many people on this call that experienced the journey that we took for, it started in October and we finished it up in March.
Okay, fabulous. A quick follow-up question before we move on to our final presenter. What's the number one challenge, Robert, for clubs that have never had a $10,000 fundraiser? What's the problem? What do they need to work past in order to get there?
Well, I think the biggest problem is just starting and doing it, because you need to test. First of all, you need to have a platform to do it in, one that's resilient and supportive. There are many out there. I happen to work with one called Event Group, but I mean, you got to start it, because if you don't start it, you'll never get it moving. And then you got to test and just keep focusing on the cause. And the cause, to me, is what's going to drive the success.
Right. Well done, man. I so appreciate you. Thank you for being with us. Robert is available to speak, as are all of our cast presenters. I won't say that we saved the best for last, everybody, but we've saved the best for last. I want to introduce you to a woman who has been very remarkable on our committee. So let me frame this up for you. I'm looking at 422 participants in the call right now, many more registered. Of course, that's how it works. We did not have a website for this event. This event was primarily promoted through a single information graphic, and it was created by Christina Hope Ennis. We're going to introduce you to her in just a second. This graphic performed so well, delivering us 650 registrants for this event, that we never bothered to build the web page. Christina also created Your Souvenir Playbill using a simple tool every club should be using. She's going to show you how to create a professional graphic in less than 5 minutes. Get ready for the amazing Christina Hope Ennis.
Hello, everybody. I am so excited to be here tonight as our grand finale to Public Image the Musical, which is all about engaging, fun, colorful graphics and making them in Canva in less than 5 minutes. So I'm gonna start off with actually two bonus tips. So in the grand finale, you don't get three, you get five tips. So tip number one, get yourself a Canva account. They are free. They cost no money. Bonus tip number two, if you are a registered charity, if your club is a registered charity in your country, you can get a Canva Pro account for free. To pay for a Canva Pro account, the annual fee is only about $10 a month. But if you're a registered charity, sign up, you can get it for free. So once you get logged into Canva, my first tip is to add any commonly used images to the upload section of Canva. So to do this, you're going to first head over to the Rotary Brand Center at rotary.org and download any logos or images that you or your club frequently use or think you might use in the future using this new tool. So log in, go create the custom club logo. I know some people are still using the old logo, which is actually almost 10 years old at this point. So I don't think we can call it the new logo. Download the Mark of Excellence, which is our rotary wheel. Grab the NPolio Now logo and People of Action Resources. Upload all of those to the Canva Upload Center for quick access when making your own design. You could even upload logos of any partner organization. So if you work closely with your city or your town, you can add their logos for your materials or any other groups that you work with frequently so that they're on hand when you need them to make any type of graphic in just a few minutes. So my second tip is all about the templates and the seemingly unlimited options that Canva offers. So you can make social media posts custom to Instagram, which is typically a square, Facebook posts, Twitter posts. They all have different dimensions, believe it or not. Posters, certificates, trifold brochures, pop-up banners. My personal favorite, PowerPoint presentations. I always get asked, how do you make such awesome presentations in PowerPoint? And I say, I don't use PowerPoint, I use Canva. So when you first log into Canva, it can be very tempting to start from scratch, to select new project and just start with a blank page. But to maximize your time, start with the pre-populated templates and simply change the text and images as needed, add a logo, change the colors if you need to, basically a fill in the blanks with your own information. And that can take as little as 5 minutes to create a great engaging graphic that's going to look good on your social media or in your print materials. My final tip for you guys tonight, our true grand finale, is all about the leadership colors and using the Canva brand kit. So once again, this tip starts in the Brand Center on myrotary.org. So right on the main page of the Brand Center, you should see over on the right-hand side, it usually is the voice and visual identity guidelines. So that is a PDF document all about the Rotary brand. I found it a great read. Hopefully some of you guys do too. So you're going to scroll up two-thirds of the way down, and then you will see all of these dots of different colors. And that is the Rotary color palette. You'll find the typical Rotary royal blue, the darker navy, the red color for Rotaract, the lighter blue for Interact, the Rotary wheel yellow, and a whole bunch of other highlight colors. So if you pull those into Canva, you can essentially quickly turn any graphic or template into something that looks Rotary within seconds. And the other great thing is that any combination of these colors are going to work together. So it really takes that guesswork out of do these colors work together? You could close your eyes and pick whichever colors from that color palette, and it would work and it would look Rotary and it would be a great graphic. So that was my last tip for Canva for this evening.
Well done, Christina. Thank you so much. I was really amazed that you could create such intricacy. Wait till you see the playbill, everybody. It's really a work of art. There's so much information in it. And I would have never thought to do it in Canva, but we also were able to share the document and have people add to it. Christina turned us all on to that. I really appreciate you. Thank you.
You are so welcome. It was a really fun document to create. I really enjoyed making it.
Christina, you're available to speak to clubs and districts and whoever wants to learn more about this, correct?
Absolutely, I am. So I'm available to talk about this. Devankar and I have been doing talks together. So if you want our speaker team, we are happy to join your club or your district or what have you, or your committee, as you were mentioning earlier, Michael. But I would love to come chat with you.
Very good. Thank you, Christina. You're great. So I've noticed some people are posting the link to the playbill in chat, so you can download it from there. You can also download it from the Zone 28 and 32 website if you'd like to do it some other time, but we highly recommend that you pick it up. We're asking all of the cast members to turn their cameras on now and join me for some closing comments. We hope that you've enjoyed Public Image, the musical. We've certainly enjoyed putting it together for you. Be sure to visit the Zone 28 and 32 website on occasion just to see what's going on. If nothing else, go there to get your playbill so that you can contact our cast members and consultants to speak for you. We hope to see you soon and often on social media, and of course when the world opens up again, which is coming soon. We want you to mark your calendars right now for the first ever Zone 28 Public Image Awards. This will be a virtual event. It's happening on Wednesday, August 18th at 7 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. That's August 18th. It's a Wednesday at 7 p.m. Eastern Daylight Time. Now, these are the Zone 28 Awards, but you may want to attend even if you're not in Zone 28, because one of the things that we're going to do that night is we're going to interview the winners of the awards and have them teach us how they did it, exactly how they did it. And that means you can benefit from that evening, even if you're not a Zone 28 Rotarian. So at a live event, we might say something like, be careful driving home, but tonight we'll just say, be careful walking to your bedroom. Thanks for all you do for Rotary, the greatest service organization in the world, and enjoy our exit music, everybody. Thank you so much. The cast members will be in chat here to answer any questions as we play you out. Brad Hollett, cue the music.